Samantha, first you're watching Big Picture with me, Frank Rasul Pereira. Since you're here, let me ask you, have you liked the video and subscribed to Bharata First? If no, then please do so now. Do subscribe to our newsletter to get some incisive information. And how can I not tell you about the Bharata First Knowledge Center, our big success story? It is your one-stop destination for all your competitive exams needs. We now have 26 amazing courses all available at less than 1,000 rupees per course as part of our early bird offer. We are also offering an additional discount of 10% for the first 100 to register. So what are you waiting for? Make use of this great opportunity and register now at kc.bharatafirst.com. Hundreds are reaping the benefits of the Knowledge Center. Don't be left behind and don't regret later. All this information along with some must-see recommendations are in the description of the video. Please go through it. And now onto the discussion. The Union Health Ministry released the summary findings of the fifth round of the National Family and Health Survey conducted in two phases between 2019 and 2021 on November 24th. NFHS is the most comprehensive survey on the socio-economic and health indicators in the country. While the results of the first phase were released in December last year, country-level statistics were released only on the 24th of November last week. The results of the survey show some surprising demographic transitions, such as women outnumbering men, and some expected ones, such as fertility rates declining. They also highlight the health challenges that remain, such as moving towards addressing nutrition deficiency or other deficiency, apart from just food adequacy. And they offer a more sobering picture of the impact of government schemes on access to basic amenities such as clean cooking fuel and improved sanitation. In this edition of Big Picture, we will analyze the National Family Health Survey 5. Joining me on the program today are Professor S.K. Singh, Department of Mathematical Demography and Statistics, International Institute for Population Sciences, Dr. R.K. Srivastav, former DG Health Services, Government of India, and Professor Rajiv Dasgupta, Center for Social Medicine and Community Health, JNU. Thank you to all my guests joining me on this edition of Big Picture. Dr. Srivastav, let me start the program with you first. Let's first try and understand and analyze, you know, key takeaways of the NFHS 5.
You know, NFHS is a regular exercise done at an interval of about 10 years, this time done at an interval of about 5 years. This exercise was supposed to be completed, but got delayed on account of COVID. Now we have got full report. The takeaway from this exercise are in form of some data and indicators which are translated to certain type of estimates for future action. The main data and indicator are covering about the population, the health, the nutrition. All these data are collected by a very meticulous method of collection and analyzing it by the scientists who are well versed about it. The major indicator and the major outcome of this survey, I have not read it fully, but what I could get from the fact sheet are the performance of the country is improving. The performance in the sector of anemia is not improving. There are certain bioindicators which has been taken for the NCD, which are trying to give us a little bit more direction for the health. And there are certain indicators which are talking about the convergence of various programs like women's health, menstrual hygiene, which has been added on and which are showing a better.
Absolutely. And thank you for so beautifully explaining to us what the process is like and how the process is conducted and where we stand really as far as the NFHS 5 is concerned. Professor Dasgupta, let me come to you now. You know, what stands out for you when you look at these, you know, these findings, and when you look at how some of the states have performed very well when it comes to Bihar and you know, Uttar Pradesh? They seem to have done better than what they used to be doing in the past. As a whole, when you look at all of this, what stands out for you?
Thank you. First, before we talk of what stands out, I think we owe a great note of congratulations to the IIPS, Professor Singh, the entire team, and it's been a very, very tough job this time. It's always been tough conducting the NFHS, DLHS, but with the COVID-related disruptions, the two phases, I think it's an extraordinary feat, and they deserve very warm congratulations. In addition to further to what Dr. Srivastav said, I think what's very clear now is that the sustained inputs into health and other social sector policies are certainly bearing fruit as a big, if you take in the big picture. However, at the same time, the multidimensional poverty index figures have been released by the Niti Aayog. Again, that's a district level indicator, and one will need to read both the NFHS 5 and the MPI indices to actually make greater sense of what's happening at district levels. And that's where planning, implementation, and the challenges ahead lies. The big story, as we know, is the total fertility rate coming down to 2.0. However, we'll need to see whether it sustains over the next few years to be actually able to conclude that India is at a replacement level. But it's certainly a very big achievement. And the praise ought to go out to the women of India as much as the frontline workers across various departments. What's worrying, among other things, are the nutrition indicators, and particularly given the fact that we have very ambitious targets in the Poshan mission, that certainly seems to have taken a setback.
Absolutely. We'll get to the other worrying factors really and what they could be, you know. But we'll get to that adjustment. But before that, let me bring in Professor Singh into the picture. You know, Professor Singh, when you look at the numbers, and you know, I know a lot of work has gone into this. It's a big exercise that is carried out. What do the numbers tell us? What do the numbers tell you in specific? And anything that you would like to talk about as far as the numbers are concerned?
Basically, the number of households covered in this survey is 636 lakh household over 700,000 women. And but if you are looking at the key messages emerging from these results, my first message will be COVID-19 pandemic has delayed the services of maternal and child health utilization, but services are not denied. Government is able to provide services to maternal and child health services. Why I am giving this statement? Because about 40% of survey included in NFHS 5 has been done in a pandemic situation after November 2020. And other important finding, as Professor Dasgupta has already mentioned, that India has, when the country is celebrating Amrit Mahotsav of our independence, India has reached below replacement level fertility. That will be the beginning of population stabilization. Of course, it is going to take almost 35 to 40 years in population to be stabilized and start declining, if we are able to sustain this. That's a condition. But real challenge is the adolescent fertility and teenage motherhood. Second important issue is that in terms of maternal and child health services, as Dr. Srivastava told, after NRHM 2015 to 2021, within a short period of 15 years, we have got a tremendous progress in maternal and child health services. And today India is standing at a position that we are likely to achieve SDG target well before 2030. That's a good news for the country. Institutional delivery has, in case of institutional delivery, we are almost at the verge of achieving our target of SDGs, which is 92%. NFHS 5 results shows institutional delivery of 89%. The gap between institutional births and skilled birth attendant has been vanished in our country. That's another good news for the country. But again, there is another side effect of that. C-section birth in private institutions is increasing. That needs to be addressed on a priority basis, because the way it is increasing is beyond any medical explanation. My fourth important issue, which I would like to mention here, is definitely at national level, decline in malnutrition is not significant, but 10 states it has been declined significantly, including Bihar, UP, Haryana. That is why even in the malnutrition, our Poshan Abhiyan is working very effectively, and that we are academicians are attributing to the improvements in maternal and child health interventions at the country level. Now Poshan Abhiyan should focus at supplementary nutrition, which is primarily around our ICDS program and iron supplementation. Dr. Srivastava has mentioned about anemia. That's really a concern. We are not able to bring down anemia. Women's empowerment in this country on all the indicators has improved considerably, but unfortunately, about one quarter of women in our country are still facing one or other form of violence. Violence against women is a matter of concern. For that, there is a need of sensitizing community level, Mahila Mandal, women's organizations, and male involvement is also extremely important. These are the 5-6 takeaway messages. NCD is another problem. I should not ignore that. Yeah, with increasing population aging, whether you can say because of increasing population aging, or changes in our dietary practices, changes in lifestyle, both hypertension and diabetes. First time we have measured in a 15 plus population to align with SDG requirement, and results are very problematic, okay? Both hypertension also and diabetes also needs attention. That is primarily because of increasing obesity. Both men and women, if someone analyzes obesity data of NFHS 5, it is increasing not only in urban areas, even in rural areas also it is increasing. Absolutely. What may be the reason? I don't want to go for reason behind this. But these are the 6-7 key messages one should look at that. One more thing which I would like to clarify, because I was hearing Honorable Prime Minister's speech also in Vigyan Bhavan. Many people are highlighting that number of females in this country has surpassed males based on our sex ratio estimates, which has increased from 991 into NFHS 4 2015-16 to 1020. This interpretation should be done a bit carefully. Reason is that NFHS has a special definition of household, which is called modified de zero. It is neither de facto nor de zero. That is why around 30 crore single male migrants who are existing in this country cannot be listed as usual residents of their own household. They are usual member of the household, but they are not usual resident of the household. That is why they will not be included in their household population. NFHS also consider visitors who stayed last night. In India, who will be visitor mostly? Girls, daughters who are visiting their parental house. These may also, in addition to increasing female sex ratio in the country, in addition to increasing expectation of life at birth for female, which is almost 2.5 years higher among women in comparison to men, that is also contributing. Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao Abhiyan, that is also contributing. But whatever I have mentioned, two factors, those two factors should also be taken care. This is through your channel. I would like to bring out this important caution before media, because I have seen all newspapers, leading newspapers in the country, have given this message. That message should be taken slightly carefully. Thank you. Thanks.
Since we are here, Professor Singh, one quick follow-up on this. So what will be the more realistic figure? Because the newspapers and news media houses are reporting 1,020. Is that so? What would it be, plus or minus?
No. Let us not guess. This is a very, very wrong speculation. We should not say. I am simply cautioning that these 991 to 1,020 should not give a sweeping remarks that female population in our country has increased. We will have to account for all those factors.
Correct.
That will require a deeper analysis to give the actual situation.
Absolutely.
Before giving this statement. Reason is that I have given NFHS has adopted modified zero population.
Absolutely. Points taken. Thank you for clarifying that and thank you for so beautifully explaining the numbers to us. Dr. Srivastav, coming back to you now, you know, as a whole, there seems like there is an improvement really as far as all the yardsticks are concerned, if I can call it that. But there are some states that are still lagging behind when it comes to certain criteria and certain aspects. How do we change that? What can we do to turn it around?
Actually, if you look at the gradual progression of NFHS from 1 to 5, you will find that the penetration is going deeper. Now we are at the district level, so we have got certain database indicators, estimates, projections available. Now, if we try to look at it and try to correlate it with the state which are not performing well, there are some states which are not performing well, and these states may be at par with the national performance, but when we look at district level, that district level performance may not be up to that level. Even if you look at TFR, fine. So there are certain type of district level intervention which are needed to be taken place, which require modification in the existing program, or at some places introduction of the new program. So if we are trying to look at certain poorly performing states who are not able to achieve the indicator, whether this indicator is about a national level achievement, we have got a method, a database, which is giving us direction to make corrections. Number two is that there are certain type of indicators which are coming to us. There are certain type of database which are coming to us, which can be utilized with the help of existing technology, application of artificial intelligence, and putting analytics so that you can have a predictive mapping, which way it is going to be there in the future. Now, if we apply this second thing in those states, particularly with those interventions, which we call usually a targeted intervention, we will be able to bring more focus for the correction. The third thing is that at the end of the day, these not so good performing state contribute towards delay in achieving the target of SDG 3. You know that there are 30 indicators there and 131 indicators over there in the NFHS 3, NFHS 5. So these indicators point you to prioritize, a priority setting exercise by the state government, so that you can put more money, more human resource, and more capacity building in these areas. And lastly, but not the least, the dividend which are coming forward is about the women's health, and the dividends which are coming about the adolescent health, they need to be looked into and dovetailed into a system of women empowerment, which is one of the important target area of the SDG.
Absolutely. Thank you, Dr. Srivastav. Professor Dasgupta, what are the concern areas really when you look at NFHS 5? What stands out for you from a concern point of view?
Well, I would flag two, and let me take up both these, which have already been flagged by Professor Singh. The first, of course, is the consistently increasing rates of cesarean section, and as you very rightly said, it's just beyond belief, and therefore it's certainly not a good signal. A far greater degree of investment needs to be made into social behavioral research to find out the determinants of this. It's also equally true that the National Rural Health Mission and subsequently the National Health Mission has been also trying to support and augment cesarean section in institutions or at levels where it was not available, so that it's available where it is needed, genuinely needed, in order to bring benefits to both the mother and the newborn. But a whole lot of this cesarean section is also in the private sector. We also need to understand whether different insurance schemes and mechanisms, including the publicly funded or the state supported ones, have a role and to what extent. And some of this earlier evidence has been there from existing schemes. So that's something we seriously need to look into, and we are way below the WHO benchmark, as we know. And the other thing that was highlighted is the increase and continuous increase of non-communicable diseases, NCDs. The time has come to move away from very sectoral approaches of diet, exercise, etc. So the government of India has already adopted the multi-sectoral action plan, and both with the support of the WHO country office as well as with the national government and some key academic partners, a process has been initiated to be able to operationalize this multi-sectoral action plan at the state levels and down to district levels. But it's an enormous task, it's an enormous challenge, and this is a completely new paradigm that we would be operating in. But it's really something that needs to be given a whole lot of attention, and the urgency of this is borne out by the data.
Absolutely, very, very valid points there, and let's hope that this particular issue is addressed sooner rather than later. Professor Singh, let's talk about the sample size, and several media houses have spoken about how it's a limited sample size and may not bring out the real picture really as far as this exercise is concerned. I want to get your thoughts on this and your clarity on this, because you work so closely on this. So what do you have to say about what the media is reporting about the sample size and how we may not really know the exact picture?
Thanks a lot. Thanks for this important observation. Unfortunately, we are not organizing any session for media. Media sensitization is must. I realize this. We used to organize data users workshop. We used to caution media whenever we are going for a state level, because even first phase states also, when reports were released by Honorable Health Minister then media started writing as per their own interpretation. Many times there is a deviance. Absolutely there is no problem. With 636,000 households, NFHS5 is the largest survey in the world. Largest survey in the world. It is a very scientifically designed study. Sample size has also been determined by taking a very scientific principle where we are taking 5 parameters, including design effect, for determination of sample size. We are also taking non-response. Approximately 1,000 household per district we are taking, which is enough for providing estimates on all maternal and child health indicators. There are certain indicators which may be where relative standard error may be slightly more. That is why for that, even for a smaller state, absolutely there is no problem of sample size. Sample size is not at all a concern. Wherever we are getting number of children less for like immunization among children, we are giving at district level. There, we are all southern districts, southern states and southern districts, where number of children are less than 25. We are not giving estimate, we are putting a star. Wherever there is sample size at district level, for in case of children, is 25 to 49, we are putting that figure in bracket. Even in our fact sheet also, we are giving in footnote what is meaning of those star and bracket. But that is not for media people. That is primarily for academicians, because our media colleagues are taking trends. How is the trend? There is nothing wrong in that. For policies and programs also, we are looking at the big picture which is emerging from these results. I would like to add one more point, because our panel has already highlighted four issues for prioritizing in future: malnutrition among children, anemia, increasing C-section, and NCDs. I will add one more variable, that is age at marriage. 7 states in our country, there is not substantial reduction in age at marriage. Those states are Assam, Tripura, West Bengal, Bihar, Jharkhand, Andhra Pradesh, and Rajasthan. Here, what is happening? There is existing huge disparity by socio-cultural and ecological factors resulting into discrimination in case of marriage, aversion, inheritance, and gender treatment. Unless until those cultural and ecological factors are not addressed, it may not be feasible by our government health intervention, our frontline workers, to motivate parents for increasing age at marriage. That is why the issue is slightly beyond control of our government intervention. For that, a local level, regional level intervention with active role of religious leaders may be required. But because we all are knowing that if age at marriage is low, modern spacing method prevalence is low, then maternal mortality and early childhood mortality, both are going to be adversely affected. That will be work as a barrier to our achievements in maternal and child health program. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
All right. Time to get quick closing comments now from all the panelists with the best way forward. Starting first with you, Dr. Srivastava.
Thank you. I think it is a very good exercise completed, which has given us enough indicators and enough estimates to act at national level, sub-national level, and prescribe targeted intervention at the level of the state and the district. Second thing which I would like to point out, that all said and done, we have to look at anemia from all the angles so that we can bring it from increasing to at least decreasing in coming years. Number three is that there is such a huge database which has been created. There should be an additional work which should be taken up between the NHM and NDHM, so that this large information and data which are available are converted into world of evidences for predictive medicine, which is very important for the NCDs, which are going to cause a lot of problem in future. And lastly, we feel that there is a need for supporting the state through innovative financing, where there are extensive targeted intervention, cost intensive, needed.
Absolutely. Thank you. Professor Dasgupta.
I'll make two specific points. First, on the need for additional or newer data requirements, something we haven't looked at, and that will become increasingly important with NCDs and aging, is disability, particularly as the world has a rehabilitation 2030 agenda. So, and disability is very central to family health and support and rehabilitative services. So that's something the team may consider looking into. And secondly, as I said earlier, we need to understand this data more, particularly along with the multidimensional poverty indicators that are now available, invest into research, both health services, as well as other disciplines such as demography and social research, and then really get into designing, prioritizing that Dr. Srivastava certainly rightly said about, and designing solutions rather than jumping into very quick fix solutions. Thank you.
Absolutely. And Professor Singh, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
continuation to what Professor Das Gupta has mentioned about, I would like to talk about health financing. There is a need where government should, after health policy 2017, welfare mode to insurance mode. Of course, there is an improvement in health insurance coverage in our country from 29% to 41% in NFHS 5, but still we are required to go long away where we will have to strengthen health financing scheme by strengthening our Prime Minister Ayushman Bharat program even to reach to the people, for poor people in the country, to tertiary care. Second important point, that household environment is one of the important marker of health situation in the country. Because of government flexi program, there is a drastic improvement in access to improved sanitation facility. But our Ujjwala Yojana has, despite of all these program, only 59% household in the country are using improved clean fuel for cooking. Of course, fortunately, Prime Minister has already announced the second phase of Ujjwala on 10th August 2021. We anticipate that that should now pick up a pace and it should definitely cross above 80% within next 1 year or so. That is why health financing in one hand and key driver, which are very small, okay, clean fuel for cooking, improved sanitation, clean drinking water, and sustainable energy, green energy, which is there, which is one of the important in our COP26 conference. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, gentlemen, to all of you for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. Well, what's coming out of this discussion is that the survey is the largest and most comprehensive one of its kind anywhere in the world. 6,36,000 households were covered and was an extremely scientific exercise. The findings are positive and through them, targeted interventions can be carried out. The five major problem areas that came out through the survey are anemia among women, rise in C-sections, malnutrition, age of marriage not improving, and of course, the non-communicable diseases going up by many fold. What is required is local level intervention. Everything can't be centralized. For this, changes need to be made in our policies to empower the local administration. Schemes like Ayushman Bharat are helping, but we need a more robust health financing system. SDG 3 has 31 indicators and the non-performing states are stalling progress. That is something that needs to be addressed. Now, before I go, let me once again remind you to like the video, subscribe, and hit the bell icon, and do share the video as well. Do subscribe to our newsletter to get some incisive content. And how can I not tell you about Bharata First Knowledge Center, our big success story? It is your one-stop destination for all your competitive exams needs. We now have 26 amazing courses, all available at less than 1,000 rupees per course as part of our early bird offer. We are also offering an additional discount of 10% for the first 100 to register. So what are you waiting for? Make use of this great opportunity and register now at kc.bharatafirst.com. Hundreds are reaping the benefits of the Knowledge Center. Don't be left behind and don't regret later. All this information along with some must-see recommendations are in the description of the video. Please go through it. That's it from me. See you again next time.